their lunches. I'm going to encourage you to keep eating. Our luncheon keynote understands that this is a luncheon keynote and that folks will be continuing their meals. But we do want to get started because we're so privileged to have Kristen Toll with us today from Microsoft Research, one of the preeminent scientists here in the state of Washington, who will be able to share some of her thoughts and research and her team's research in the area we're looking at today in clean water technology. Kristen is the Director of Environmental Science in Microsoft's research offices in Redmond and co-editor of the book called The Fourth Paradigm, Data-Intensive Scientific Discovery. She's been at Microsoft for 14 years, the majority of that time in Microsoft Research. And by the way, I note that we've had at least one student from the University of Washington Tacoma Institute of Technology who's gotten employment at Microsoft Research, which is a real tribute to that program and the quality of students that we're producing here in the South Sound. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Kristen Toll.
Thank you, and thank you for having me here today. It's a little bit of a different experience for me because when I talk about the acronym DOM, or D-O-M, it actually stands for Data Object Model, not Dissolved Organic Matter. So it's, but I promise I won't throw too many of those acronyms out there, and I hope we'll leave plenty of time left for us to have discussion at the end of my talk. I do work at a very small company just north of here. You might have heard of it. So I'm in actually the research branch of Microsoft, and we have several labs around the world, but our lab is a lab actually along with our Cambridge lab in the UK that does a lot of work in environmental science. So my agenda for today is I'm going to do a little bit, give you a bit of a history of, you know, why did we create it, what's the impact to our company. Also, what's the impact of the kind of research that we do inside of Microsoft Research, which is what I refer to as a basic computer science institution, and how that impacts you. And then, you know, sort of a warm-up to the panel that's coming up after me that's going to be on big data, small water. I'm going to actually talk about big data and big water with a flood that occurred in Texas. So you probably are wondering, you know, what is the impact on your lives and your experiences that happens in regards to computer science research? And I think rather than trying to answer that question now, I'll talk a little bit and see if you can answer that for yourself at the end. Oh, maybe not. If only there were a large technology company nearby. So back when Microsoft Research was founded, it was in 1990, from a memo to Nathan Merville to Bill Gates, we created these three main goals for the types of research. And I'm really proud to say that after 22 years, we still have the same mission that we always have had, even from its inception, which is advancing the state of the art in the fields which we choose to do research, transfer the best types of research into our products, and also ensure the computing of Microsoft and also in computing in general. So we have six labs around the world. This allows us to do recruiting globally and get the best and the brightest types of talent. I'm very glad to hear that we've got a student that was hired in from University of Washington at Tacoma. I myself have had several programs and academics that I've worked with the University of Washington, and when I come to the end of my talk, there's going to be a section where I talk about a collaboration that I'm doing with the University of Washington as well. But our headquarters is also, for the research lab, is also in Redmond, along with Microsoft, Cambridge, UK, Beijing, India, New England, and New York. We actually make up a very small percentage of Microsoft's overall population, the research organization, less than 1%, but we have a lot of impact on the company itself. So for instance, I'll drop right down to number three there. The intellectual property, and this is mostly based on things like patents, 20% of that actually comes out of our organization, with the other 80% coming out of research and development in the company. Another one that's actually relevant to this, skipping down to the second to the last one, is that, and really an interesting way in which I myself am measured is, how do I facilitate time to discovery? So it is the impact that we have by applying basic computer science research and partnering with different organizations, whether they be government, NGOs, or academics, and try and enable facilitating time to discovery in these different areas of field, so that we can actually have the last one there, which is long-term impact for everyone. So when you think about Microsoft, you always think about the products. And virtually no product that Microsoft ships has not been touched in some way by the research organization. I'll give you some examples as I go along. So let's start with things like natural interactions. I mean, everybody's heard about the Surface and the experience of being able to touch. But there are things that have gone into it, like, for instance, a very popular thing, the Kinect. First of all, I want to be completely candid and say that the idea for the Kinect was not developed inside of Microsoft Research. It was a very innovative gentleman who was actually in our Xbox, Alex Kipman, who came up and conceived of the idea. The problem was that he couldn't get it to work. So one of the advantages of being inside of a basic research organization that doesn't necessarily working on just computing is that we develop technologies that can later be applied in products, and Kinect is an example of that. So for instance, there was an organization in our Cambridge lab where they were developing the ability to be able to take MRIs and x-rays and other types of medical images and identify features in them, like kidneys, and it would do it in real time. That was always the barrier. The barrier for these folks was that they didn't have the ability to do real-time recognition of body parts. But we got so good at doing this for medical imaging that we were able to actually find the margins on tumors inside of your liver, so that it's pretty easy for us then to say, this is your wrist, this is your head, this is your chest. And we, using machine learning, we could sample information very quickly and be able to very quickly create a something that's actually become the largest consumer project in the world. The other thing that we've done is we've actually worked in speech recognition to remove echoes and reverberations. I don't have a mic, so I was going to kind of show you the different sounds and how we've improved it. But so I'm going to skip over a few things in my talk because there isn't any actual sound to the presentation. But one of the other areas was this sort of disambiguating from background noise. And you see this in TV shows all the time. In fact, CSI actually regularly, the show, CSI, stops by and says, what do you got cooking? And they'll actually bake some of these things into their next episode because, you know, for us it's not science fiction, it is real. One of the things that we do, and again, I'm going to use this term unintentional research, but of course, ultimately, as you saw from the first slide, I mean, we do have to add value to the business of Microsoft. But we developed this tool that actually allowed people to create their own machine translation systems. And this is very important in an era where we find that languages are disappearing. They're literally being crushed out by major languages like Spanish. Actually, Spanish is right now is one of the biggest language killers. Russian used to be a big language killer. It's actually becoming much less so. English used to be one of the biggest, but it's also becoming less so. Spanish is probably one of the bigger ones. But right now, believe it or not, Swahili is crushing out languages because it's becoming the lingua franca of actually Africa. So we're seeing a lot of indigenous languages die out. So what we said was, well, we don't want to work like some other very large companies who do machine translation and take people's data and then spit out a translator. What we'd rather do is empower the community to develop their own. And so we created something called the Microsoft Translator Hub. And the Translator Hub started out, as I say, the sort of ability to crowdsource the development of a machine translation system and to do some language preservation at the same time. However, this has become one of the most commercially successful projects that was wholly developed inside of Microsoft Research. And you might wonder why that is. Well, if you think about it, you're a car manufacturer, And I'm not going to name any names of some of our customers, but you're a car manufacturer, and you have been developing car manuals for your particular car for years. And you pay tons of money because your cars go everywhere in the world. So you're going to need to develop a manual for every single model of car that you ship, for every single country that you ship to, and even for some languages within countries, such as the Spanish that we speak in the United States is not the Spanish that's spoken in Spain, is not the Spanish that's spoken in South America. When you enable someone to create a custom translation system, you also enable someone to create my own company's translation system, so that I can then take all the manuals that I've built over the years, feed that in as corpora to a machine learning system, and out the other side comes a manual that only needs to be corrected, and the cost for businesses is dramatically reduced, because we do charge them for the compute time, but we don't charge them for the translation system. And because it's a private one, even for language communities, we thought about privacy first. What we did is we said, all right, you own your translation system, you decide who has access to that translation system. And this worked very well for companies as well. So overnight, it started earning a lot of money. Microsoft Research is actually, it's not a non-profit, but it's a not-for-profit, which is a different thing. So we actually had to figure out a way to transfer the funds from this successful project to one of our business organizations because we couldn't actually take the profit inside. But this is accessible. You can just apply to get a hold of it. What we've done with this particular tool is we've taken the difficulty out of creating one of these systems, try to create drop-downs. And not only have we done this, I mean, there are other things that I'll show you where we sort of made things easier for people to use. Now, one of the things is we know this, that speech recognition is hard. And people always say, why is this such a hard problem? We could get to a certain threshold, and then it just wasn't very good after that. Well, thanks to an innovation that actually took place in our Microsoft Research Beijing lab called deep learning, which is now being used by all of the major companies, we have been able to dramatically improve doing speech recognition. So it's been a huge success. I was going to show you another video here. This is actually where we had our former Rick Rashid has actually moved into our Windows organization now. The head of Microsoft Research now is co-run by Peter Lee and Jeanette Wing. But he actually, not only do we have a system that translated for him at this particular conference in Beijing, but it translated for him using his own voice. And when you think about the barriers to business being able to communicate across and not have the problems, you can see how this is a great advantage. And so Skype, which is one of our divisions, is actually integrating the machine translator hub for people to actually do this for speech now together. One thing that I know, and I spend a lot of time going to environmental science conferences, and even though I'm not an environmental scientist, I'm actually, my background's in biomedical computing, is that every one of these guys wants to build their own device. They want to build their own collection of sensors because everybody has their own purpose for it. So in Microsoft Research, we also have developed something called Gadgeteer. And what Gadgeteer allows you to do is it allows you to take components without having to solder and put things together. We actually developed it as an education tool for kids, believe it or not, so that they could figure out how to create some pretty cool stuff. This one, one of our early ones, we took it to a K-12 school, and this one kid had a little monitor on one side, and if you tapped him on this shoulder, because it had a pressure sensor on the other shoulder, it would actually play a video on his lapel, on this coat that he built out of these Gadgeteer components. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to lower the barrier to people actually crafting their own unique individual devices. And there's different modules. You can order these as packs, put them together. They're super interesting for kids. By the way, that monitor is the thing down there in the far right-hand corner. And then it's very easy. It's got a drag-and-drop kind of programmable interface for each one of the tools, so you could then tie the modules together. If you touch one, it activates another. It's got an event-based model that allows them to very quickly do it. And like I said, we're actually taking these into schools and training kids on how to use that. But The other thing that we're seeing these days, and particularly in conjunction with this conference that's really relevant, is we're trying to see how people can make things more efficient. And one of the places that we really, really want to do this is we want to do it in our homes. So we've started developing a technology, for a platform, quite literally, for managing everything from the couch that we just recently talked about at the, there's this big UbiComp conference that was here in Seattle that could tell you how you were feeling, and maybe that's not so relevant. But what is more relevant is that we could actually tell when you're driving around by your GPS location whether or not your thermostat should be turned on in your home. So maybe it's midday, you happen to be passing by because you're going to the doctor, no, it's not going to kick on, but it knows, it learns your system for when you're actually going to be around the house, so therefore it can turn on your thermostat based on machine learning about you and can personalize the experience. That's why I actually used Siri in the previous slide because she's the voice of all of our lab of things. So the other thing is we want to help out with is we want to help enable research at scale. And a way of doing that is, like I was talking about with the Machine Translator Hub, is to actually make it easier for people, reduce the barrier for people to getting infrastructure on the cloud. Now, I've heard quite a bit about the word infrastructure today, but even in my title, which is the Director of Infrastructure, the kind of infrastructure I think about is this kind of infrastructure, which is computing infrastructure. And quite literally, you can create any sort of virtual machine by following a set of wizards and drop-downs. I'm not joking about this. So getting up on the cloud is much easier than it used to be. So and in addition to this, here's some of the drop-downs. Like, you can even set the size of the machines that you need. You can test them out, see how that works with the capacity for your web services or even for the applications that they're running, really sort of demystifying the experience of using the cloud. But our real, that's actually the business side of things. But our role has actually been to facilitate getting researchers on there. So we developed this program called Azure for Research. And this is a program whereby we give grants to people to test out Azure and put their research up there and make it available on the cloud to others. It's very simple to apply, but as part of this, actually, we're training academics on how to use it. They simply fill in a very simple form to receive a research award. We do make sure that the research is meritorious so before we award it. But this is literally the form that people fill out, and then they just have to attach a one-page proposal to that in order to get access to the program itself. As I said before, I get sort of measured literally by facilitating time to discovery, and I like to work in the pressing areas, and nowhere really are things more pressing, I think, than they are right now in water or in healthcare. So what do you think the dirtiest thing is that you see in this photo? Yes, okay, well, so you guys already know about this. My husband's a doctor at UW Medical Center, that would have not been his answer. But you're right. It is the keyboard. So one of the projects that I worked with, this is actually done with Edinburgh Hospital in the UK, was developing using the Kinect sensor for someone to pull up CAT scan images using gesture, flip through the images, segment, select, all of this stuff can be done with gesture in the surgical theater, because what these guys were doing is they were literally pulling the cuffs of the sleeve over because they didn't want to use their fingers and get them dirty, as if that were any more sterile, and tapping this dirty keyboard. So by making it touchless, one of the metrics that we're using is the reduction of staph infections inside of hospitals. So speaking of pressing issues, 1.8 million people die every year of HIV. That's 5,000 people every single day. I wish I had more. I wish I could say we're working on Ebola right now, but we have been working on AIDS for vaccine for several years in conjunction with the Harvard Medical School. And what we're using is something that we developed for Hotmail. It was a spam filter. So the way that spammers get mail to you and they bypass the current spam systems is that they mutate. And this is exactly what HIV does in your bloodstream. It mutates. So what we do is we locate weaknesses or commonalities that occur in that email. It's the same sort of idea when we're looking for the epitopes that commonly occur within a particular population to know where to target it. Because what we want to do is find out where the virus is weak. And that's where we want to send it. Because if you do a full spectrum type of vaccine like they did a few years ago with the Philippines, you can actually give people who don't have AIDS, because you've now introduced the bug to their system, or it's absolutely useless because you've overwhelmed the immune system with so much information that it actually doesn't have enough B cells and T cells to attack the disease in the first place. So finding the target, the very specific epitopes where it's weakest is the way to actually develop a vaccine that can do something. And we did that using a machine learning tool called PhiloD. And this, like the Gadgeteer technology, is also open source and available. And we're working with several HIV groups around the world now, including looking at maybe even doing a clinical trial here in the near future in South Africa, with over 32 papers, several of which are in Nature Medicine. Closer to home, or maybe farther from home, depending on how you like to think about it, is our Worldwide Telescope. While this is a great, awesome, free tool for looking at the sky, it also comes with an Earth mode. And what we want to do is open this up to people to be able to put their data on the Earth and be able to visualize that in multiple dimensions. So not just the three dimensions of the globe, but literally then having multiple data sets shown on there at the same time. And with that, one of our product teams, actually Office, decided that they were going to integrate that right into Excel. And this is a free download that you can do as an add-on to Microsoft Excel, where you can quite literally look at the shape of the Earth and then plot your data on it. These are actually usages of the power grid data that I'm showing on these particular slides. But what about water? I mean, that's what we're here for. We're here to talk about water. And it just so happens, I mean, one of the things I always consider it an advantage is that by being able to work on some of these pressing issues, there's nothing really more pressing, I think, than water for us. But what I'm doing for a specific project, we do work in clean water, we do work in dissolved organic models, or dissolved organic matter, biogeochemistry, snowpack. But I'm going to target this one because this is actually a project that I'm deeply involved with, and it's on flooding. So you would ask, why would we target flooding? Why would, in particular, a company like Microsoft do that? Well, first of all, it's extremely important to our nation very specifically, and it's a matter of national security. Right now, we're over $28 billion in debt for the flood insurance program, and on average, even in years when we don't have a Hurricane Katrina or a Superstorm Sandy, it's on average $8.4 billion of cost to the United States every single year. We want to do this to drive the Microsoft technologies. We want to push to the limit the technologies because when we're talking about big data, this isn't just big data, this is a tsunami of data. And we have motivated collaborators and partners engaged here. Both from, from government, from other industry folks, standards body, and even academia involved in this particular project. My main PI and collaborator is actually David Maidment. I'll come to him in a few minutes. But I wanted to say I know we just are about to come into Halloween, but last year I was visiting my collaborator David Maidment in Texas. And it just so happened I was in Austin on Halloween. And during Halloween, they had a massive flood where 700 homes were actually damaged, 5 people were died, and the early warning systems for this flood completely failed in the city of Austin. Now, that's not to say there wasn't a monitor. There was a monitor. But what happened is the water got so high that monitor was so overwhelmed that while initially, sometime around midnight, emergency response was notified that there could be a problem. the sensor became so overwhelmed it then went offline. And so they just stood down. So it was a failure of the system itself, because the data they then received was that, oh no, everything is okay. For some reason it went from red to green. And so they stood down and they had this disaster actually while I was there. It also happened to be the weekend for Austin City Limits. So the reason why we've gotten together with, as you can see, loads of different government agencies. We're working with ESRI and KSTRS. The standards body of the groups on like GEO, the Open Geospatial Consortium, and QASI. There are numerous institutions, including the University of Washington, that are involved in this project, trying to actually work on doing data interoperability. And you think, well, what's the problem? Well, many of you know that data comes from disparate data sources. But what we want to do is connect at the national scale a flooding model with the local emergency folks so that we don't see another onion crate flood happen. And we want to carry it out in near real time and improve the emergency response. But also, then the last one's one that's most important to me, is that we want to collect this data together and serve it up to people so that they can do other things with it. It shouldn't just be something that's kept to a small number of people. It should be something that's publicly available, because it's based on public data that we as taxpayers have already paid to have generated. So we have authoritative sources of information. USGS is responsible for the past, the National Weather Service is responsible for the future, and the Army Corps of Engineers monitors our reservoir data. But these things are not actually together right now. They're not in one common place. That's why we have to have this interoperability experiment. And then this needs to be tied to the flood mapping project that's being done currently by FEMA. So it's really sort of integrating this notion of space and time, right? Each of these actually are on different time scales. A lot of times the data is on different types of grid sizes of data. So being able to do spatial aggregation and temporal aggregation in such a way that the data is actually usable to people is one of the big things that we're trying to tackle with this experiment. So also the coverage isn't there necessarily. Some of the places the coverage is spotty. So how we interpolate is going to be a big key issue as well. With USGS, there's actually 13 different systems rather than one system for the whole of the United States. We have 13 that we have to contend with and munch together into a single one. And they're big. So what we wanted to be able to do is simulate using that and then the NHD plus system out of NCAR, and bring that all together into something where we actually can run simulations and be able to do some predictive analysis so that we end up being a little bit more proactive rather than reactive in disaster types of situations. So part of this means we have to develop these very important predictive models that, based on all of these different systems, then result in something that gives us near real-time types of results. And I'm not sure if this is actually going to run. We'll see. Nope, it didn't. Okay. Or RAPID, depending on which part of the world you're on. Cedric David is the person who actually developed this model. Cedric was a visiting researcher in my lab, along with Marcela Somos, who they spent the summer with me, and my intern, Fernando Salas. Developing this model for being able to determine what the flow rate is and then visualize that information. So bringing all the pieces together, what we're doing is we're actually going to be taking process of geospatial data. We're going to actually model the stream flows using the RAPID model and then put the data storage, that all up into a data storage service. It's actually being done in conjunction also with the University of Washington. And service that up using WaterML, which is a common data standard for supplying hydro data. And then use a workflow to do the predictive analysis. It's actually work being done with UIUC in Illinois to then spit out the model information and be able to do the hopefully downstream notification services. I think my students put some interesting builds into here. So one of the things that I really wanted Fernando to do during his internship was to do a pilot. He and Marcelo, who came in, and Cedric, who came and spent some time with me. Actually, Cedric Davis now at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, but was to spend some time actually leveraging Azure, seeing if this could be put into the cloud and could be served up to others to calculate these models in the cloud. The first thing we did is we did a soil and moisture model. The next thing we did is actually took the region around Texas did stream flows together. And then we managed to take all of that information plus the NHD plus put that together. Fernando worked on the one that's actually the West Gulf region, and then Marcel actually developed a model at the end of September for the northeastern region. So these are the two pilots that we've been showing to folks at FEMA to show that actually the feasibility of this is possible. But then the question is, how do we scale that up to the whole of the United States? And we're going to do this in conjunction with a new institute that's just been established by the National Weather Service. This is actually the National Water Center. It's in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And they're going to support all of the system and be able to even host the data and serve that up in a way that will be available to other researchers, literally becoming a hub of information for the United States for doing this disaster preparedness. And the timeline for this, so again, we had the pilot that was actually here at Microsoft Research. We did that pilot, that was through the end of September. Now we're working on actually creating an interoperable database design, bringing all the tools together. What we then hope to do is run a summer institute at the center, the National Water Center, inviting lots of researchers and PhD students to bang against the data, which is why it says play at the end there. That's also my student, Fernando. But that's going to be taking place in time for July. This will be for the United States. In the following year, what we hope to do is a little bit more federal and local integration, because right now we're using just federal data, and then be able to do some more regional streamcasting, being able to downscale the models so we could actually tell you personally, based on your GPS location, are in trouble right now, or your home is, or your business is in trouble. So being able to do notifications that are a little bit more personalized, downscaling that to the more of a local level, so that we can do better planning and mitigation response, create these local alerts, and then do impact assessments in advance of when these events actually occur using a 10-day moving window. So why is it important? The reason is, this is a case study that was actually done in Peru, where they determined that these would be the lives saved if they had better notification. But I think actually an even bigger one just happened less than a week ago in India, where they had a massive flood. They predicted it by the weather. They knew that the storm was going to be very bad. And they evacuated 1 million people. 5 people lost their lives. India is notoriously bad for disaster response. But, you know, that's a perfect case study of why it's important for us to have these pre-notification services, because they literally saved probably tens of thousands of lives. So bringing us back to the Halloween flood and the New Creek Woods scene, one of the things that would have helped is actually these types of sensors that are mounted on the bridge rather than using the regular stream flow ones. They're really relatively inexpensive. They're only $3,000 each. And being able to put these there, also using technologies like LIDAR and radar from the satellite images, bringing that data in. These are also for future directions for this particular project. The builds. this allows us to be more proactive rather than reactive in types of situations like this. So the other thing that we've been testing out is actually to see if the SEAM system would work for droughts. And we believe with early preliminary data that we'll also be able to do drought prediction as well as flooding prediction. And all of this is rolling up to what is the Open Water Data Initiative, which is something I'm a member of that particular committee. But this is also part of the President Obama's Client Data Initiative as well, where we're actually moving from maps to data and to services. And, you know, maps release, we were still using them up to 1990s, really moving more recently into digital data and web services. But in the future, we really need to be able to provide these things as interop services and notifications literally right to your cell phone. Not that you're in a county or a region that could be flooded, but you yourself, your house, your address, you're in danger, your livelihood is in danger, your home is in danger. So, I mean, it's really, in conclusion, it's really important that if we're going to protect the population, that we have excellent flood forecasting. And this is a new methodology. It's a new type of collaboration where we literally have so many different agencies chipping in and working together on the particular problem. And with that, I will leave you. Oh, sure. Sure. Happy to take questions.
Do you have a question for Kristen? Like, when can you download this? Sure. There we go. Right over there.
It's on.
And Kristen, that was a great presentation. Very exciting what you're working on. You know, one of the things that's revolutionary in the IT industry is the development of mobile phones.
Yeah.
3 or 4 billion people now. It's essentially each of us is a walking sensor. That's kind of one way to think about it. So I'm wondering what the thinking, and you guys try to think ahead, and mobile is a pretty important part of the Microsoft agenda now, I think.
Yep, mobile first, cloud first.
Right. Well, so what are your thoughts about how to use the network of people who have these mobile phones, build database, crowdsource data, you know, to get the stuff visualized, how it might help in the whole water disaster area and so on. I'm just wondering if you could opine about what the importance of mobile and Microsoft research.
So I think it's twofold. I mean, there is this capacity. One of the areas that we've been doing a lot of research in is mining things like tweets. People are out in the field and, oh my gosh, there's a tornado heading my way, or oh, there's a wall of water going to come and hit me in a minute. I mean, people are tweeting. So we have a lot of people who are actually working on the data science side of things of trying to mine that data for early warning systems as well. At the same time, I think that what mobile phones are, as you point out rightly, is they are sensors in and of themselves. The fact that I could give you a notification down the line, year two of the project, by the way, we're still in year one, that I could actually notify you personally that you are in danger based on the GPS location in your phone, is also means that you personally could crowdsource and or notify someone of a problem from your phone, and that information would go along with it. I also think that, and I've been talking actually with the University of Washington at Tacoma about there has to be mechanisms whereby we can actually do water quality capability. Right now, I mean, there are folks who go out with big boxes, and they are wonderful volunteers who go out and do water quality in the area. But getting these things, like using things, I mean, Gadgeteer is a little bit of overkill. It does way more than what you need. But there are smaller sensors that quite literally you could not replace that whole box with a small sensor and have people input the information, crowdsource the information about water quality or effluent in our streams and in our rivers. So I've, you know, my former life actually, before I was doing environmental science, I was also director of our health and well-being program. I think that mobile phones are a democratizer. They literally make people part of the solution, but they also, again, can save lives. It can actually provide them with information to save their lives. And I think that, in general, if we keep people more informed, they will be more proactive about things like littering and putting things into the water system that perhaps they should not. In the same way in which healthcare, which I think is an advance really of environmental issues, notifies you when you should take your medicine or tell me if you're not feeling well, if you haven't, or you need to take your diabetes shot or something like that. These are now very commonplace. But what we haven't really done, I think, in the environmental space is use phones for the health of our own planet. Our own local areas, like the Puget Sound, the health of the Puget Sound, the health of the rivers that supply us with information, with life, actually.
right here. This will be the second and last question.
Okay.
I love the project. It's wonderful. And Dr. Maidman's reputation is sterling in the civil environmental engineering area. So great that he's involved in it. Data has got to be part of the solution, but I wonder, is calibration of the predictions of these things, is that a challenge in making this work? And or do you kind of start this by going better safe than sorry, better to be over-correcting and notifying more people than less?
That's a great question. So with each one of the models that we calculate, we work in the uncertainty. It's important because, you know, when you use any sort of machine learning type of tool, to be able to report the error bars. The problem is that you and I, we understand error bars, but not necessarily does the public understand error bars. So while I can't say how we will err with regards to doing the notification services right now, because we haven't really got to designing that phase of the particular project, we just know that's a long-term objective of it. What I would say is that at no stage of reporting will the uncertainty not be reported along with the actual metric which we provide.
Thank you again, Kristen. Microsoft Research, a great example of one of those institutions, this time coming from the private sector as opposed to the public sector, but that is bringing talent and innovation into our region and certainly out to the rest of the world. When we talk about ecosystems within the economic development world, we talk about developing these clusters of talent, and we're so fortunate to have Microsoft devoting the resources that they do to a not-for-profit within the company that's now been in place. I didn't realize it was for 20 years now. Very significant in what we're all able to do, both in the water field and in a number of other areas, healthcare analytics, a number of other things that we're working on here in the South Sound. So very timely, very much appreciated. We're going to take about a 10-minute break. Before we move to our next panel, I think the folks are going to come in and continue to clear some of the dishes.